Good evening and welcome back to Stretch Drive. I'm Lloyd McDonald along with Greg Blanchard, and tonight we've got a terrific lineup for you at home.
Tonight we've got a full 1 hour coming your way. Next, it includes racing from Mohawk Raceway in Ontario, as well as coverage from racing here throughout Atlantic Canada. In our driver profile this week, we meet a veteran reinsman in Jody Hennessy, and we also have a feature story from the Atlantic Vet College here in Charlottetown. So stay tuned, it's coming up next on Stretch Drive.
This evening's show, Greg, we're going to again go back to 1979 and have a look at a flashback race from the Charlottetown Driving Park.
Another in a continuing series here of flashback races. Tonight we've got a good five-horse field facing the starter here, including one trotter and four pacers. We're going to have a look now back to 1979.
There are five starters in the seventh race. This is a preferred classification. Number one, Belinky, trotter in with four pacers, Lem Neal driving, H.H. Carroll 2 with Jody Hennessy, another Macca 3 with Francis McIsaac, four aces Pal with Blois McPhail, and Fine Rebel on the outside. Alec McPhee driving, they head into the turn, and here's Fine Rebel digging from the outside for the lead. H.H. Carroll is up on the inside, another Macca 3rd on the turn, racing fourth, aces Pal with Belinky trailing by the first eight. Here they go on to the quarter. Fine Rebel paces off the top, looking good, going to the quarter by 2.5 lengths on H.H. Carroll. That's another Macca racing third. Aces Pal is fourth as they go by the quarter. Belinky trots in fifth. Heading into the top turn, racing to the 3/8. Fine Rebel by 1.75 now. By the quarter, 31-2. H.H. Carroll is second. That's another Macca third. Aces Pal still fourth. And the trotter Belinky is trailing. They're turning for the halfway mark in the seventh now, and it's still Fine Rebel, number five, racing off the top by 1.75 lengths to the half. Second, it's still H.H. Carroll back 2.5 lengths now. Here's Aces Pal driving the outside and taking third from another Macca. There by the halfway mark, the trotter races up in there with the pacers in fifth. Racing for the 5/8. Now the seventh race is on the paddock turn by the half in a good 4.4. Up front, it's still Fine Rebel by 1.5 lengths on H.H. Carroll. On the outside, Aces Pal third. That's another Macca fourth and Belinky trailing. Here they go on to the 3/4 now. The trotter's going to give it a shot. Belinky from 5 moves up on the outside. They're at the 3/4 now and into the top turn. It's Fine Rebel off the top. 5 contenders heading for the 7/8. It's still Fine Rebel, a length and a half. 1.36 4/5 down to the 3/4. There's an 8th to go. Fine Rebel looks pretty comfortable with the lead. Here they come off the turn now. That is Fine Rebel. Aces Pal on the outside. Here they come. Up on the inside is the trotter now as they come home. Look, oh, there's another Macca on the inside. Here they are.
Those flashbacks back to 1979 bring back a lot of memories, Greg.
They certainly do. Always a nice treat to flashback here each and every week, and we've got another great one coming up next week.
We're going to go now, Greg, to Truro Raceway and have a look at the first division of the Tim Horton Series.
Well, it's the second leg of the Tim Horton Series, first division on the afternoon, and in this race, number 7, Radiant Herods was just a bit short in his first division last week of the Tim Horton Series, losing by a neck in 2 minutes and 2/5, but a good effort for his first start back in with that type of field. And number 4, MD Mitty, should be another one to watch in here. This mare was just a bit short as well, pacing a mile in 2 minutes and 3 last time with the four post. Could be much more of a factor here today.
Number six of the afternoon, second leg, first division of the Tim Horton Series has Rambo Derby, Sale of the Century, Don't Tax Me No More, M.D. Mitty, Musco Chip, Swinging Wave, and Radiant Herods. They're off and pacing. Sale of the Century is off looking for the lead. Musco Chip, then from the far outside, Radiant Herods is leaving alertly. They race on over to the opening eighth. Musco Chip grabs the early lead. Radiant Herods gets away to find the pocket. In along the rail, that's Rambo Derby now sitting third. Sale of the Century has four. Don't Tax Me No More comes away racing in five. MD Mitty is next in line six, and seventh and trailing the field is Swinging Wave. Single file past the opening quarter. Musco Chip will dictate the early pace. Leads it by one length over the pocket sitting Radiant Herods. Next in line, Rambo Derby third. Coming first up, Don't Tax Me No More is fourth. On the outside to follow that cover in five is MD Mitty. Shuffle back to six, Sale of the Century. And moving to the outside for the back is Swinging Wave. They were past the quarter in 29 and 3/5 seconds. Off the top turn, they approach the half. Musco Chip now being joined by Don't Tax Me No More on the outside. Sitting the pocket, Radiant Herods third. Second out is MD Mitty racing fourth. Rambo Derby five, Swinging Wave six. And seventh and trailing the field is Sale of the Century. They continue on to the backstretch. The half in 101. And 1/5 second, they're matching strides up front. Musco Chip on the inside. And on the outside is Don't Tax Me No More. Getting a good second over trip is MD Mitty. And she's looking three wide, third, fourth, and looking to get off the rail is Radiant Herods. They move past the three quarters on the outside. MD Mitty is now forging to the top. Don't Tax Me No More racing second. On the inside, pacing third is Musco Chip. Outside and racing fourth is Swinging Wave. Radiant Herods has five. Off the turn, 131 was the three quarters. MD Mitty has opened up by four lengths with Don't Tax Me No More in pursuit. Second, racing third is Swinging Wave. They drive to the payoff. It's all MD Mitty. Finishing second is Don't Tax Me No More. And the show spot goes to Radiant Herods.
MD Mitty, a big trip in there for Danny Romo.
Well, this mare now winning for the fourth time so far in 1995, and 201-1 there. That's two big trips she's gone so far in the opening legs of the Tim Horton Series. So she's in good form for the upcoming final.
We're going to have a look now, Greg, at the Maritime stats at racetracks near you. Brian Moore continuing to wrap up the big numbers in the Maritime racetracks.
Well, that's 39 wins now for Brian, continuing to heat up St. John Raceway right now. And he had a big day on Saturday afternoon with five driving wins. And we get a chance to look at him now in an upcoming race as he will be guiding the island-owned Leave Us Alone, owned by Alden O'Brien of Charlottetown. And this colt will be looking for his second win of 95 in here. But he will face a tough assignment. He leaves from post seven. And the horses inside of them look like they'll be very competitive.
Thomas Sutter has the horses race number five. Seven Pacers behind the gate. One, Hoosier General. Two, Edgewater Amber. Three, Springbrook Chip. Four, Confident Sabra. Five, Calabrita Jessica. Six, Fair Advise. The outside seven, Leave Us Alone. Here they come. They're off and pacing quickly, moving for the top in between horses. That is Springbrook Chip. Hoosier General gets away first, though, and Edgewater Amber takes a seat second. Springbrook Chip up on the outside now to challenge. Racing in fourth is Calabrita Jessica. Into fifth is Fair Advise. Then Leave Us Alone and Confident Sabra, the early trailer. As they go down the backstretch for the opening quarter, Hoosier General on top by a length. Racing in second, Springbrook Chip parked out. Moving third now, that's Edgewater Amber, and Calabrita Jessica has fourth. Then it's Fair Advise, Leave Us Alone, and Confident Sabra, the opening quarter in 31-1. Rounding the turn now for the 3/8, and Hoosier General leads at a half length, Springbrook Chip. On the outside to second now, with Edgewater Amber locked in third. Then racing in fourth is Fair Advise now. Leave Us Alone moving on the outside from fifth, Calabrita Jessica, and the trailer Confident Sabra starts to move from the back of the pack as they come down the stretch for the opening half. Springbrook Chip on the outside shows a nose on top. Who's Your General second? Then it's Fair Advise third. Edgewater Amber has fourth. The half in 104 with Leave Us Alone racing fifth. Cattle Livery to Jessica and Confident Sabra rounding the barn turn for the final time, and 9 to 5/8 they go with Hoosier General and Springbrook Chip. There goes Fair Advise three wide down the back stretch for the final time. Edgewater Amber looks for racing room from fourth. Leave Us Alone moving on the outside now fifth. Then it's Cattle Livery to Jessica and Confident Sabra. Fair Advise moves on to the top. As they go by the three quarters, Fair Advise leads it by 2 and 1/37. On the far outside, Leave Us Alone now to second. Hoosier General has third, Calvary to Jessica to fourth now, and she drives on. Edgewater Amber has fifth, then it's Springbrook Chip and Confident Sabra. An eighth of a mile to go, and down the stretch they come for home. Fair Advise is the one to catch. Leave Us Alone gives chase on the outside now. Calvary to Jessica and Hoosier General. Edgewater Amber shakes loose. Fair Advise and Leave Us Alone now to the top. To the payoff, Leave Us Alone wins it over Fair Advise and Hoosier General 4-3. The time for the mile? 2:10 and 1.
Brian Moore guiding Leave Us Alone to one of his five wins in the afternoon.
Very big day, increasing his win total from 34 when he started the afternoon up until 39, and Leave Us Alone getting his second win so far here in 1995.
Greg, we had the opportunity to go to the Atlantic Veterinary College last week. There was a seminar held there last Wednesday evening, and we caught up with some of the participants involved.
Well, it was a look at some of the research and some of the activities that are going on at the Vet College, some different studies on respiratory problems in horses and bleeders, and also Kathleen McMillan, a Charlottetown native, who's underwent a study last summer on fitness in horses. So it was a very interesting seminar, and we had a chance to catch up with some of the people involved.
John Pringle is the associate professor of large animal medicine at the Atlantic Veterinary College. Pringle headed up a seminar this past Thursday at the college where horsemen were offered insight into standardbred fitness and were also shown ways to maximize training techniques.
What I've been studying for the horses is exercise physiology, looking at horses that during training, problems with performance, and maybe the betterment of training techniques.
Kathleen McMillan is a native of Charlottetown studying at the Atlantic Vet College. Last summer, she did a study on horse fitness on Prince Edward Island and methods of training. And one of her most interesting finds was the variation of training techniques among the local trainers.
I did find a variation between between trainers. Some horses tend to push their horse a little harder than others. I think probably the largest variation is actually between the way that the horses responded to the training, whether they were able to deal with the stresses of the training or not.
McMillan says one problem trainers face is the ability to detect when overtraining is taking place in their horse. In one instance last summer, she was able to help a local trainer detect this through the use of a heart rate monitor. This, she says, could play a major role in future training methods.
Especially in that one case, it was only detected with heart rate monitor. If the trainer had not used the heart rate monitor, they would never have known that the horse was being overtrained because he was just going the same miles as any other horse, and it was the horse that was actually responding differently to it, to the training itself. So I think it could play a very big part in the future of training.
Another study ongoing at the Vet College concerns the problem of bleeding in racehorses. Dr. Chris Ann Kalaitis is heading up this study, and one of her most startling findings was that 85% of the horses she studied did bleed during tests under racing conditions.
The study that I did here corroborated another study that was done in Guelph, in which both myself and another investigator found that 85% of horses that race three times will bleed at least once in those three races. The only drug that is not legal in the Maritimes that has been shown objectively to help some horses that bleed is a drug called Lasix or furosemide, but it's not legal here and it's tested for, so it can't be used.
No,
The final topic discussed at the seminar involved respiratory problems among standard breds. Dr. Paula Ehrlich is heading up this study. In particular, she has been looking at a throat condition which causes horses to fatigue much earlier in a race than they normally would.
What I've looked at specifically is elite thoroughbred athletes who have a condition called laryngeal neuropathy or left recurrent laryngeal neuropathy. It's a paralysis of a nerve that causes their upper airways to collapse at speeds. They don't get as much aerobic energy as they need to finish a race. I've looked at it in elite thoroughbreds. I've looked at it in couch potato horses or pasture potato horses, and tried to compare what the difference is of the impact of this disease is on these horses' ability to perform well. What I'm hoping to do this summer and coming fall is to repeat these studies in standardbreds and have the opportunity to see what impact the disease has on them. So far, the results have been extremely interesting. In the past, folks have thought that because of this collapse of horses' upper airway, that the horse had to work harder to breathe and therefore wasn't able to finish a race. Now we understand it's not that they're putting more energy into breathing, it's that their actual ability to hit a peak aerobic power is lowered by the disease.
John Pringle says he hopes seminars like this will encourage horsemen to look at alternative methods of training and to become more involved in the ongoing research of standard bred fitness.
We do have quite a good working relationship with a lot of horsemen on the island. We'd like to reach more to let them know about what's available and also how to make themselves available to some of the projects that are ongoing.
Later on in the program, we're going to catch up with Mike Weber, the Assistant Director of Veterinary Medicine with the Canadian Paramutual Agency, and he's going to share his views with drug testing here in North America. But first, we're going to have a look at racing action from the Charlottetown Driving Park last Saturday afternoon. Greg, it was a big afternoon out there.
It very big afternoon. We had all of Hunter River almost out at the track on Saturday, a big gathering there, and they were out to support Hunter River Day, an annual event at the CDP. And the first race we're going to look at was the Hunter River Drivers Championship, where we featured horsemen from the Hunter River area, both veteran and youngsters alike, in this one vying for the title of the Hunter River Drivers Champion for 95. A wide open field in here, so it looks like any one of these drivers have a shot at it.
Off of the stretch, the Hunter River Lions Drivers Championship has one Island Nancy Jane, two Big Problem, three Romance Design, four Hillview Daylight, five Gleam of Glory, six Outside, CL's Wonder Girl, trailing horse eight, that is Caper Kelly Bird. Here they come. Rough and pacing, Romance Design getting away quickly up along the rail island. Nancy Jane, the outside, Gleam of Glory. They go driving into the first turn. Get on by the eighth mark, led by Romance Design up front. Island Nancy Jane is racing second. Gleam of Glory third. Caper Caliber moves off the rail and is moving up fourth outside. From five is Big Problem, CL's Wonder Girl, and Hillview Daylight Trails. Caper Calibird moving quickly on the outside and now takes away the lead. Caper Calibird is going to the top. Romance Design is racing a second. Island Nancy Jane showing third. CL's Wonder Girl on the outside in four. From five, Gleam of Glory, Hillview Daylight, and a Big Problem trailing 33-2 by the opening quarter. Off the top turn they come, racing through the stretch. They are led by Caper Calibird up front. Big Problem, check that outside, is Romance Design now moving on the leader as they get on by the half-mile mark. Romance Design getting a neck in front. Caper Calibird coming back on up the rail as they go racing the paddock turn second time. 104-2 by the half-mile mark. Up front, your leader, Caper Calibird, by three parts of a length. Romance Design drives up two on the outside. Island Nancy Jane racing it along the rail third. Fourth outside and moving up, CL's Wonder Girl, as they get on by the three-quarter mile mark. Romance Design getting a neck in front. At the rail, Caper Calibird still there. Caper Calibird regains the lead once again. Romance Design the outside. Here comes CL's Wonder Girl, three wide third. 1:36 and 4 3/4. Three wide, turning for home. Caper, Caliburda, Romance Design, CL's Wonder Girl. Romance Design, Island, Nancy Jean up along the rail. Right down to the wire, Island, Nancy Jean to win it. Romance Design, second, Gleam of Glory, 4-3.
Veteran reinsman Jim McMillan sneaking up along the rail in there to win the Hunter River Drivers' Championship.
A very close and exciting finish in that race, very fitting for the Hunter River Drivers' Championship. And James McMillan, he's a veteran. He's been in the bike before and had a lot of good winners over the years, and snuck a close victory away there from Carl Bagnall in that one.
We're going to go now, Greg, from a look at the veteran Jim McMillan to a bunch of youngsters in EPR, maidens racing here.
This is a maiden's class and some young up-and-coming horses. An interesting one to watch, number two class in Jig Time. This is a three-year-old Knightley Blue Chip filly out for only her second lifetime start out of the good race mare Bon Flash. So this could be one to watch, could be an up-and-comer. And there's also some other nice ones in here, a couple of Stargaze Down fillies, and another nice one in Hillview Precious from the sixth hole with John Davidson. This is a three-year-old daughter of Joe G. Hanover, another top sire here over the last couple of years. So it'll be interesting to watch this one and see who wins it.
Devastator has the horses, race number six. Eight Pacers behind the gate. One Getaway Down, two Class and Jig Time, three Rocky Fella, four Paris Down, five Road Eyes, six Hillview Precious, seven West Valley First. On the outside eight, that's Au Revoir Pasha. Here they come. They're off and pacing, Class and Jig Time out to take control in the early going. Getaway Down racing in second. Hillview Precious up on the outside now to third. Au Revoir Pasha will take a seat fourth. Then it is Rocky Fella up on the outside now. West Valley First drives on to fifth spot. Racing in seventh is Paris Down. And the early trailer is Road Eyes. Now Hillview Precious takes charge and leads it a length and a half over Class and Jig Time. West Valley First hustles up on the outside, now third, now second, and wings for the top. He grabs it away from Hillview Precious as they go by the quarter in 33 seconds. Rounding the turn with West Valley First. Hillview Precious second, then it is Class and Jig Time third. Getaway Down has fourth, then Au Revoir Pasha. Rocky Fella in sixth, then it's Paris Down and Road Eyes as they swing off the top turn and come down the stretch for the opening half, single file, with West Valley First on top by a length and a half. Hillview Precious has second. Class and Jig Time to third. Then racing up on the outside now, Au Revoir Pasha moves on to third and drives for the top, now second, and gets to the leader's wheel, the half in 105 and 2, and Au Revoir Pasha assumes control. West Valley First now second. Then it's Hillview Precious third. On the outside, Getaway Down has fourth with Class and Jig Time pacing in fifth. Paris Down out and driving sixth. Then racing in seventh, it's Rocky Fella. And the trailer Road Eyes now right back at him goes West Valley First and shows a nose on top. Then it is Au Revoir Pasha the inside second. Getaway Down a tight third with Hillview Precious fourth. The three quarters reached in 137 and four with Au Revoir Pasha and West Valley First. Going three wide, that's Class and Jig Time now fourth, now third. And driving after the leaders, Getaway Down has fourth, then it's Hillview Precious, Paris Down, Rocky Fella and Road Eyes. They're tipping out three wide off the top turn, and Class and Jig Time moves on to the front. Then it is West Valley First and Getaway Down on the far outside, Rocky Fella. As they come to the line, Class and Jig Time wins it. Rocky Fella for second, and it's tight for show between Getaway Down and Au Revoir Pasha. And the time for that mile? 2:10:03.
Class and Jig Time getting her maiden win in there with Wayne Maher in 2:10:03.
It's a little early to tell right now, but there are some good-looking potential prospects in that race there, and Class and Jig Time certainly one of them there, getting the maiden win in 2:10:03.
We're going to go back now to the Charlottetown Driving Park, Greg, and a fan favorite each and every year for Hunter River Day is the Own a Horse for a Day, and we're going to have a look at that race now.
Well, this is where the eight lucky names are drawn, and each person gets to own a horse participating in that designated race on the afternoon. And from Saturday, it happened to be race number eight. And this is a wide open affair as well, where anybody had a chance to win it. Interesting to note number two, Knotsford Maker. This is a consistent campaigner last year, making a second start back off that first tightener. should be one of the factors. You've also got the veteran Jones Little John in there, as tough a racehorse as they come. Leaves from the sixth post and could certainly be there. And number four, Joyful Jenny, a newcomer. We'll have a look at her. Ronnie Gass brings this one in from London, four-year-old mare by Quiet Force. We'll have to see how she fares out.
Race 8, top of the stretch, the Cavendish Tourist Mart. On a horse for a day race has one First Lady Kim, two Knotsford Maker, three Bellman's Dream, four Joyful Jenny, five Joe Doomer, six Jones Little John, seven Outside Aries Lois, trailing horse 8, Marview John. Here they come. Joyful Jenny, First Lady came up along the rail. Those two battle for the lead as they drive into the first turn. Joyful Jenny up on the outside is going to the top. First Lady Kim will now race second. Showing third is Knotsford Maker. Jones a Little John parked on the outside in four. As they go racing to the opening quarter, First Lady Kim wants that lead back and she gets it past the first marker. Racing a second is Joyful Jenny. At the rail third, Knotsford Maker. Jones a Little John parked out fourth. From five is Bellman's Dream. 30-1 by the opening quarter. Off the top turn they come, swinging for the half-mile mark, and the First Lady Kim shows the way. Here comes Jones, a Little John, moving up on the outside second. Racing third is Joyful Jenny. Knotsford Maker moves off the rail in fourth. Bellman's Dream is a fifth. Aries Lois wide in sixth. And it's a Bellman's Dream. Joe Dumars well back, and out of it, Marview John. Half a mile, 101 and 1/5. 3/8 left the pace, and the First Lady Kim's taking them backside final time. Up on the outside, Jones, a Little John, parked every step of the way, a neck back second. Racing it along the rail, third is Joyful Jenny. Hurries all of us going, 3 wide on the outside and four. Tightly bunched up front as they race the far turn final time, heading for the 7/8. Jones, a Little John, now coming to the top. First Lady Kim is racing second. Knotsford Maker now showing third. 1:33 and 4 by the 3/4. Jones, a Little John on top. Here comes Knotsford Maker on the outside. Joyful Jenny up along the rail. Jones, a Little John, and Knotsford Maker race it out right down to the wire. It's too close to call between Jones, a Little John, and Knotsford Maker. We'll need a picture.
Jones Little John for veteran driver, Hunter River native, Albert Bernard, winning the Own a Horse for a Day pace.
2:06 and 1 the mile for Jones Little John after being parked every step of it. So he showed what kind of class he had. And as you say, fitting that a Hunter River native, Albert Bernard, did win that race. And the lucky winner of the Own a Horse for a Day promotion was Keith Cole. So congratulations to Keith.
We're going to go now, Greg, and have a look at this week's driver profile with Jody Hennessy.
Jody Hennessy, a veteran of the Maritime Racing Wars, another one in the long list of great Hennessy drivers, and we have a chance to meet Jody now in this week's driver profile.
I was growing up with horses. My father had horses, and I've been at the track as long as I can remember. My father used to take us out here when we were only kids, eh? And we've been involved in the race game pretty well all our lives, eh? The whole family of us, really, that, especially the boys, not so much the girls, they weren't involved too much in the race game, but all the boys, all, when we got able to get around at all, we come to the track. We used to come out after school a lot once we got, that we were able to do anything. We used to come out after school. My father always had a big stable of horses, and we used to come out after and clean out the stalls and stuff like that, like to help them out, like, eh? Because Dad used to have anywhere from 15 to 20 horses at that time, and which was a big number, eh? And he never had a whole lot of help, so we used to come out after work, the boys, and we'd do the stalls for them to help out. I've drove in a lot of tracks, Lordy. I drove in at the Mall at the Maritimes, and I drove in Blue Bonnet some, Monticello, and I drove a race or two at Freehold. This was quite a few years ago, and I drove at Richelieu Park, which was outside of Montreal. It was a half, it's not there no more. It was a half-mile track. I drove there some, but I never drove any amount of racing out of the Maritimes, really. I drove most of my driving right here in the Maritimes. I've hit some pretty nice horses for Jack Brown. I had Glen Towey in and Starland in. And then I had Glen Reynolds was a nice horse for Soggy Reed. And of course, I never had Christopher C. Down, but I drove him for 2 years there, which was a pretty nice horse. And I was fortunate enough to get to drive Winners Alcalay too when he was racing pretty good. And he was probably one of the best horses that's ever raced in the Maritimes, Winners Alcalay. He was a real, real nice horse. It's a good honor to drive a good horse, Lordy, but at the same time, it's not as hard to drive a good one as it is one not so good. What I mean is a good horse will kind of look after himself, and they got the speed, they know, it's just a matter of getting them placed and getting them moving on. But it's not that hard to drive a good horse. It's a lot easier to drive a good one than it is a poor one. When you hear it, fellas like Joe O'Brien and them fellas from where, he was from here. If you pick up the books, it was always Joe O'Brien or Billy Houghton, Stanley Dancers. There's all kinds of names back then that you kind of looked up to. You never seen much of them, but if you got a chance to see a film on them or anything, you always jumped to see it, because you wanted, they were the best in the world at that time. But as I say, you take a fellow like O'Brien that come here right from PEI, he's done everything in the race game that could possibly be done. And not only to the Islanders, he was noted all over the world as the best horse driver that ever lived. In the Maritime Provinces, Lordy, in the race business, you can only go so far. There's only so far to go. There's only so much you can do. It's been proven. There's fellas that's left out of here. They've done all they could do here in the Maritimes. And they've gone away now, and they're all making names for themselves. The Paul McKenzies, the Rankins, my brother Wally, the Downies, they're all away making a good living. They all were here, worked hard here in the Maritimes, and done pretty well all they could do here. And they went for better things, so they all moved away and doing good. And I think it's anybody that's involved in harness racing. And they like, it's nice to start here at home, nice to do what you can do. But I think everybody should give themselves a chance to see if they can better themselves, in this race business. I guess the biggest race I ever won, I win the Alexander. I win mostly all the major events, but I win the Freddington big races there, and I win the Alexander Memorial two or three times, and I win the one in Moncton there. The biggest race that there is the Gold Cup, and I've never won that one. I guess perhaps that's the only one I haven't won. I win the Governor's Plate twice. I win with Winners Alcalay 1 year, and I broke track record, and I broke the track record with Glen Reynolds. I won it with him, too. I have a little over 1,800 wins.
You're going to get that 2,000?
Well, I don't know. It don't look like I'm going to get it this year, and I haven't got too many horses here right now, Lordy, but I will eventually if I live long enough. I was pretty fortunate in this race game. It's been good to me, and as I say, we had a great teacher. My father was awful good around young horses. We more or less copied off him, and I was fortunate enough to get some decent horses, and I got away. I went to St. John and got some more decent horses. I think I'll stay home now, Lordy, if I can get some horses together, I'd like to come back home here. It's always nice to get home, especially when you're away like that. And I'd like to get a few horses here if I could for the summer. And just from there on, just let it fall where it may after that. But I'd certainly like to pick up some horses here and start for the summer here at Charlestown.
Well, Greg, it's nice to see Jody Hennessy back on the island.
Well, it won't take Jody long to reestablish himself here. He's a top horseman, and I'm sure it won't be long before you see him racing a full-fledged stable here on the island.
We're going to go back now to Truro Raceway and have a look at their second leg of the Tim Horton Series.
Well, in here, the heavy, heavy favorite will have to be number 2, Cat Scooter, and Danny Romo. 2 for 2 so far in 1995, and he looks better than ever. And this son of Rumpus Hanover with the inside post should not have any difficulty beating this field. Number 1, Jammer Time, finished 2nd to him last week and should be able to come up with the same kind of effort from the number 1 post.
Race 11, top of the stretch. Second division of the Tim Horton Series has Jammer Time, Cat Scooter, Bird Tanner, Zesta's Prince, He's All Talk, Escorts Abe, and Cindyella. They are off and pacing. Cat Scooter off to grab the early lead. At the rail is Jammer Time, getting away second. Bird Tanner settles in third. Up on the outside, He's All Talk is on the limb and hustles out looking for the lead. They race by the opening eighth and on down the backstretch, led by Cat Scooter. He's All Talk parked out second. Jammer Time sits along the rail third. Taking a look in four as they head to the opening quarter is Bird Tanner, fifth along the rail. That is Zesta's Prince. Outside racing six is Cindyella. And trailing the field is Escorts Abe. They race onto the top turn. And dictating the early pace is Cat Scooter by one, getting the perfect trip. Will be Jammer Time second, gathered back to fill the gap third. He's All Talk. Now moving up first over is Cindyella in four. Zesta's Prince follows the move five. Along the rail in six is Bird Tanner. And still at the back is Escorts Abe. 28-4 was the opening quarter. As they move past the halfway point, Cat Scooter a length and a half on Jammer Time. On the outside second as they dip into the bend and racing first over is Cindyella along the rail. He's All Talk. Second out, Zesta's Prince is pacing in five. Then sixth at the rail is Bird Tanner. Trailing Escorts Abe, 59-4 the half through the backstretch. They move on to the three quarters. And they're still chasing Cat Scooter. Maintains a length and a half lead on Cindyella. Second on the outside. Jammer Time getting the golden trip will await the passing lane third. Second out, fourth is Zesta's Prince. He's All Talk along the rail. Has nowhere to go. Five. Escorts Abe. Three wide. Six. And seventh and trailing now is Bird Tanner. They race off the top turn. Three quarters in 1:31. They straighten out through the lane. Final time. Cat LaBosse along the inside. And enjoying the perfect trip. And still second is Jammer Time. Cat Scooter. Jammer Time will try him on the outside. But he runs out of ground. Cat Scooter wins it. Second is Jammer Time. Escorts Abe catches the show spot.
Danny Romo guiding Cat Scooter home in an off track 201-3.
Cat Scooter continues to go undefeated for 1995. Looks like a top contender here, going to be a top contender, I think, throughout the summer meet. This horse is going to be very tough in the final.
We're going to go back now to Exhibition Park Raceway and have a look at an 8-horse field in here.
Well, this is race 8 from their program on Saturday afternoon, and the bettor's choice in here is number 3, Burton Breeze, and Brian Moore doing the driving. Winless so far in 1995, but has 7 seconds to show in her 14 starts, so definitely a threat. And the other favorite will be number 1, Cathedral Rose, and the driver, Gordy Hennessy.
The starter has the horses, race number 8. 8 pacers behind the gate. 1, Cathedral Rose. 2, Party on Garth. 3, Burton Breeze. 4, CB Golden Rum. 5, Chipalong Down. 6, Toot and Tellum. 7, Fly Dini. The outside 8, Tennessee Jed. Here they come. They're off and pacing quickly, winging for the lead. Chipalong Down on the outside. At the pylons, that's Burton Breeze. Party on Garth gets away third. Then on the outside, Toot and Tellum moving fourth. And Fly Dini driving on now from fourth. And on to third spot, racing in sixth as they go past that eighth is Tennessee Jed. Then it's Cathedral Rose and CB Golden Rum down the backstretch for the opening quarter. And Chipalong Down is being challenged by Fly Dini on the outside, and she takes the lead away. Racing in third is Birds and Breeze. Then it's Party on Garth in fourth, the opening quarter, 30-2. Rounding the turn for the 3/8 now is Toot and Tellum fifth. Then it's Tennessee Jed, Cathedral Rose, and CB Golden Rum, single file, rounding that 3/8 turn with Fly Dini on top a length and a half. Then racing in second is Chipalong Down, Birds and Breeze with an eye to the outside from third, Party on Garth has fourth. Then it is Toot and Tellum, and Tennessee Jed picks up the cover sixth. Racing in seventh, Cathedral Rose, and moving from the back of the pack, CB Golden Rum, as they reach the half in 1:03. Fly Dini continues to dictate the pace. Racing in second is Chipalong Down. On the outside, Party on Garth has third. Then it's Birds and Breeze. No place to go from fourth. Tennessee Jed driving fifth with cover on the outside. Then it is Toot and Tellum. And up on the outside now, CB Golden Rum making the trailer Cathedral Rose as they go down the backside for the final time. Fly Dini is the one to catch. on the outside and driving on. As they go past the three-quarters, is Party on Garth, three-quarters in 135. They're starting to bunch up as they go on to the seven-eighths. Moving three wide is Burton Breeze on to third, and on the inside, no place to go for Chip Along Down. Then it's Tennessee Jed and CB Golden Rum, Cathedral Rose and Tootin' Tellum. They're moving four abreast as they come down the stretch for the payoff. It's Party on Garth, and on the inside, Fly Dini, Burton Breeze, and Cathedral Rose into the picture. Now Burton Breeze and Party on Garth to the finish. Burton Breeze gets up to win it. Over Party on Garth looks like Tennessee Jed for third, over Cathedral Rose in the time for that mile, 2:07:02.
Once again, Greg, Brian Moore heading down victory lane.
Yes, just continues to win, and Burton Breeze there winning in 2:07:02, first in 15 this year for Burton Breeze.
We're going to go now, Greg, and have a look at that interview with Mike Weber.
Well, Mike Weber, involved with the Canadian Paramutual Agency, and drug testing is his particular specialty. And he explains to us now a little bit about what is involved in drug testing and a little bit about the image of drugs in harness racing.
There's some consistency there now.
Mike Weber is the Assistant Director of Veterinary Medicine for the Canadian Paramutual Agency, the agency responsible for drug usage and testing throughout Canada.
We have a research facility in Jerseyville, Ontario. We maintain a stable of standardbred horses. We administer drugs and medications to these horses. The purpose of the program is to develop new tests for the control of drugs and medications in racing, and as well to develop elimination guidelines for the use of veterinarians and trainers who are medicating horses but do not want to violate our rules. So we give them some guidelines as to the use of legitimate medication. We use the medications at doses that are recommended by manufacturers. The horses are well-maintained, they're trained, they're fit horses.
One of the most controversial issues facing the industry today is the use of what are known as milkshakes. Weber says there are a lot of misconceptions about milkshakes among the betting public.
The term milkshake refers to a solution, concoction of baking soda, regular baking soda that is put into a slurry and given to the horse by a stomach tube or in the feed. And the intent or purpose of the milkshake or the use of the sodium bicarbonate loading, is to offset the lactic acid buildup that occurs in racing. And lactic acid builds up in muscles and basically causes a horse to become tired. So the theory is that if we can offset this, the horse will not become as tired in the race and will perform better. Unfortunately, there is not good evidence as to how much is the right amount and how much is too much. So there must be some kind of controls put on. The other aspect of the situation is that as regulators and the betting public, we are looking for consistent performances. And the use of milkshakes may result in very inconsistent performances.
How much better can a milkshake make a horse?
I really don't think anybody knows that. It's a hit and miss situation. The best scientific trials done have indicated that it may have no beneficial effect. In some horses it has a deleterious effect. They in fact may perform more poorly, and in others no effect. And in still others, there may be an improved performance. So it's not an exact science, that's for sure.
Overall, Weber feels the sport is basically free of rampant drug use. He says most problems occur from incorrect administration of medications.
The use of drugs is really there's not a rampant use. The testing has never been more sophisticated or better than it is today. And I really don't think, I'm confident, there is not a rampant misuse of drugs. There's a perception that there are more drugs being used than what there really are being used. And in fact, a lot of the substances that people claim to be using on a horse or have rumored that other people are using are very innocuous substances, such as vitamins, etc. So I think we're getting a lot of bad knocks. Racing is getting a lot of bad knocks. We are much more severely and heavily policed than any other form of sporting venture, including the human athletic field. Historically, we've talked about everything that went into a horse as being a drug, and the word drug doesn't connote health to me. So I like to emphasize your medications. And I think this is a very important point. Well over 90% of all our positive tests in Canada are for the inadvertent or careless use of reasonable medications. That's something that I really want to emphasize to you people. We're well regulated, severely regulated with respect to drug and medication control, and in fact most of our violations involve legitimate medications. Just the timing of it has been wrong or careless, timing of the use.
Well, that certainly clears up a lot of the misconceptions about drugs and harness racing.
Well, there are a lot of misconceptions out there, especially on the part of the fans. And like Mike said, a lot of times when you get this type of thing happening, it's not actually blatant disregard for the sport. It's a lot of just people maybe administering drugs incorrectly, medications and that type of thing. So a lot of it is misconception. And I think especially with the controversial milkshakes, which have really come on the scene here in the last few years, and hopefully this problem will be eliminated soon.
We're going to have a look now at upcoming events at racetracks across the Maritimes. Now, Greg, at the top class from Saturday afternoon at the Charlottetown Driving Park, and Ian Moore is Quick Challenge back in again.
Well, we've got 8 speedsters going to the gate here, but Quick Challenge is certainly the class of this field, going for a purse of $2,000 on Saturday afternoon, and Quick Challenge looks like certainly the one to beat in here. He's 3 for 3 since coming to the Maritimes, sports a mark of 153-4 taken last year at Mohawk, so certainly one to beat. But there are some other real nice racehorses in with them. You've got Blazing Finesse, KJ's Monster, Dallas Rocks, horses of this nature. So they'll try to provide as much competition as they can for Quick Challenge.
Ninth race of the afternoon, top of the stretch, the top-notch heating pace from the rail out, Herod's Image, post 2, Dunaston Dazzler. From 3 as time goes by, 4 Blazing Finesse, 5 KJ's Monster. The outside post is Quick Challenge. Trailing horse is Dallas Rocks. Here they come. They're off and pacing. 5 wide up Finesse, the lead of the gate. As time goes by, Herod's Image, Blazing Finesse on the extreme outside. As they drive into the first turn, Dashed and Dazzler goes to a break at the back. Up front, Herod's Image is the early leader. As they go racing it up the backstretch first time, as time goes by, rushing up to on the outside, Dallas Rock showing third. They arrive at the quarter mile mark. As time goes by, is moving to the top. Second is Herod's Image, Blazing Finesse on the outside, driving third. 29-3 by the opening quarter. Blazing Finesse wants that lead. As time goes by, has it as they swing off the top turn. As time goes by, shows the way. Blazing Finesse, here comes Quick Challenge. 3 wide on the outside. As they get on by the half-mile mark, Quick Challenge is moving to the top. Quick Challenge now by 2 open lengths. As time goes by, second. Blazing Finesse, the outside, third. They were by the half and a minute flat. Quick Challenge on top by 3 open lengths as they race the backstretch, second and final time. Quick challenge by four. As time goes by, well back second. Pleasing finesse on the outside third. Quick challenge now opening by five as they get on by the 3/4 mile mark. Quick challenge is your leader by seven as they race to the 7/8 mark. 1:29.4 by the 3/4. Going 2 minutes speed as they swing for home. Quick challenge is just that. He's quick and unchallenged as he races through the stretch for the mile. They'll race fair place in this one. They're not catching. Quick challenge today. KJ's Monster second. That's close for three.
Quick challenge in rain to Earl Smith, another Hunter River native on Hunter River Day, setting a new season's mark for the park. 2 minutes.
Big, big trip. This horse has tremendous high speed. Is going to fit in real nice, I think, with the free-for-all rank once that gets into full swing, and that's a big trip, 2 minutes flat.
We're going to go now to Mohawk Raceway in Ontario, and Greg, we have a chance to look at a maritime performer in here, Master Cam.
Well, Master Cam was a very nice performer here in Atlantic Canada, a winner in early spring at Truro Raceway at 159 in capturing the Pepsi Series there for three-year-olds. So since he's gone up to Mohawk, he's been racing very well. First or second in two of his first three starts, and sports a new race record of 158-2, and looms big in here with driver Rick Zeron. The stiffest challenge should come from number 6, Global Rage. Paul McDonnell has this one, a 3-year-old son of Armbrough Global. He's been first or second in all of his first three lifetime starts. Sports a mark of 157-4. So on the program, it looks to be between number 6, Global Rage, and number 9, Master Cam.
And the gates rolling, cruising by, Bid for Freedom, and Henchman Hanover starting on the inside three. Center of the track to Easy Driving, Regal Harbor, and Global Rage. On the outside, Paradise Cam and Hawaiian Hano, post 9 to Master Cam. It's 10th race post time from Mohawk. And there they go. There, off and pacing, Bid for Freedom, having some bad steps, the extreme outside leaving there, Paradise Cam and Hawaiian Hano. Now out to the lead is Bid for Freedom, Easy Driving, driving up alongside him. On the inside third, that's Henchman Hanover past the eighth pole, and following through to be fourth is Master Cam, looking to get inside five, but still parked out is Regal Harbor, just in behind that one, Global Rage. Then the trailing trio, after delays leaving, cruising by Paradise Cam and Hawaiian Hano to the quarter in 29 seconds. Here's Easy Driving coming on for the lead. Easy Driving takes over and opens a quick four on Bid for Freedom. Easy Driving, Bid for Freedom, Henchman Hanover, Master Cam is fourth. Regal Harbor is back there fresh from fifth and flushing out the cover of Master Cam in front of him. On the outside, sixth is Global Rage. Paradise Cam in seventh, cruising by is eighth. Hawaiian Hano is ninth, and moving to the outside, the flow begins on the way to the half. Easy Driving coming first up quickly is Master Cam, aggressively into the pocket, Bid for Freedom, and second over Regal Harbor. The half was 59 seconds. 30 seconds, the second panel, and they're ready to match strides on the front end with 3/8 to go. Easy Driving, Master Cam right alongside him. Not for long, he's looking to go right on by. Regal Harbor is third on the outside, Bid for Freedom in from fourth. Global Rage is fifth on the outside, back there in sixth. Paradise Cam, and then it's back to Hawaiian Hano, backing away. Henchman Hanover is eighth, cruising by is ninth. The new leader at the top turn, Master Cam, but he's got Regal Harbor right in behind him. 127-4, the third split. 28-4 down the backstretch, and they turn for home. Master Cam and Regal Harbor comes out from in behind him. Master Cam still pacing strong. He's got a two-length lead and is going to finish it out. That is Master Cam in front. Regal Harbor second, tight for third on the inside. Hawaiian Hano made a big recovery after a delayed start against Global Rage, the photo for show in 157.
Master Cam lowering his lifetime record to 157-4.
This horse is certainly fitting in nice on the Ontario Jockey Club. Two wins now and four starts for this one since going to Mohawk Raceway, and has pushed his seasonal earnings to over 12,000 in the process.
Well, Greg, that's all we have for our viewers this evening, but before we go, we're going to have a look at last week's trivia contest winner.
And the lucky winner was Carl Bagnall of Southport, who knew the answer to the question, who is the track record holder at the Summerside Raceway, and what is that track record time? And of course, that record is held jointly by Christopher C. Down and Kilcarran Ingle in a time of 1:57.1. So Carl Bagnall, the lucky winner. And Carl, you can pick up your starter t-shirt from the LFJ Productions office at the CDP on race nights.
So until next week, we'll see you again here on Stretch Drive.